Rahu is similar to Saturn in many aspects, and Ketu to Mars as well. That's why.
Now, why do they say that Ketu is similar to Mars? It's the higher version. Mars is, imagine that soldier which is saying, I will go and conquer the land. For whom? For the sun, for the king. Suppose you go and kill your enemy, who wins? Ultimately, the sun wins, right? The body doesn't win. Body is not the king. I mean, you are that king who wins. But Ketu, they say, is the higher version. So, higher means what? It shows something which you have already conquered, which you are not fighting anymore for.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, because the sign for Ketu is a flag. Flag means, I have conquered this. This is my land. There's no question. There's no confusion. There's no argumentation. But that's the precarious state. No flag in this material world is for eternity. You may be the president of the United States, but for maximum how many years? 8 years?
Yeah.
Maybe tomorrow they may change the constitution, maybe for 16 years. Or maybe they say, you can become president for all time. But then the question is, how long will you live? Maybe 70, 80 years? After that, you will perish one day. So, the problem with Ketu is that we think we have permanently got a flag. Permanently got a flag means I am here, she's my wife, he's my husband, this is my territory. Nobody comes inside. Anybody comes, I will kill you. But the problem is, one day anyways they will go. Either they will die or we die. One of the two will happen one day.
Yeah.
So, when that happens, what happens is, there is a level of headlessness. Ketu is headless. So, when people come to you during Ketu Dasha, time period of Ketu, Rahu is more of, as you said correctly, Rahu is more of, okay, I have 10 options. What will I do? Ketu is more of like, I have everything still. What do I do? Because Rahu wants to conquer. Ketu doesn't want to conquer. Ketu asks you, look, you got your land, you have your wife, your husband, everybody's there. So are you happy now? Question mark. So whenever you think of Ketu, imagine a person who doesn't have a head, but there's a question mark. That's like the head. Because whatever you have in a way, one day will be taken away from you. So, there the principle of Mars and Saturn comes. This is something very funny here. You know, they say Mars and Saturn are opposites. They say like this. But it's very peculiar. And they say both are malefics. I mean, if Mars was a malefic, and if it's opposite to Saturn, then Saturn should have been a benefic, right? And if Saturn was a malefic and Mars is opposite, Mars should have been a benefic. How come two planets which are opposite to each other, but they are like both malefics? Because the Bhagavad Gita answers this question. You will not find this in any astrological text. You will not find it in any conference. You won't find it anywhere. You will only find it in the Bhagavad Gita. And you will find it in the Srimad Bhagavatam, of course. What is the reason? The reason is that what Saturn represents basically? Saturn primarily represents the pain which we get when we lose something. I had this great person, this great job. It's not there anymore. She is not there. That's the pain. It's very painful. And what actually happens, if you see most of the clients that you will get, I mean, may not be 80%, but 30-40% of them will be, I just had a breakup. When will I find somebody new? So when there is a breakup, what actually happens? People will say, oh, your Venus is afflicted by Saturn, Rahu, Ketu, blah, blah, blah. That is why this breakup has happened. Or the planet whose dasha you are running is sitting in the sixth house of separation or whatever. That is why you had a breakup or you fought with each other. You will give all sorts of explanations. But do you actually know what a breakup is? When somebody is very happy in a relationship with somebody, then what happens? Have you heard people say, she is my girlfriend. He is my husband. So basically, why the son, the ego feels a lot of comfort that, look, in my territory, I have somebody. Not that you are beating or you are killing them or you are dominating that person, but still you get a feeling that he's mine. She's mine, you know, that I, me and mine, it's very strong. That's the sun basically. So whenever you are having a breakup, what is happening? That person is rebelling against your territory. That person, see why everybody is interested in relationships. Because in relationships, hopefully, or it's expected that your partner will give you some special treatment. He will bring a rose only for you, not for the girl next door. So that means what your partner is doing. Basically, he's acknowledging the position that you are like the sun. That is why, have you seen people making statements? My world is you. My world revolves around you. Which means, like, all the planets are revolving around the sun, like this. All the nine planets. So that boy or that girl says, you are like my sun and I revolve around you. The moment you get up, I send you a morning text. Before I sleep, I send you a text. I do this, I do that, what not I do. You are very special. This, have you heard this? Yeah. You are special to me. So, when there's a breakup, what happens? That special treatment is gone. It's like somebody telling you, you don't exist for me anymore. He doesn't reply to you. He doesn't pick your calls. He has blocked you in Facebook, WhatsApp, whatnot these days. So that's what Saturn is, because now you understand why the Sun and Saturn are enemies in astrology. Because Saturn says that I will pull you down. And when he pulls us down, what happens? Our identity gets threatened.
Our ego.
So therefore, yeah. So when you have a breakup, what happens is you may give all explanations. Oh, I'm emotionally shattered. This happened, you know. I'm tormented now. But the main reason why you are crying is your ego is shattered. You thought that person is yours and now that person doesn't give a damn about you. Which means he has said, oh, you are shining like the sun. Do hell. Do hell with it. Get lost. You don't shine for me, basically. You know. There's no light in you. You don't exist for me, basically. So our independent existence in this world, which is the sun, is threatened. That is why people commit suicide sometimes. You think it's only for the emotional trauma they are committing? No, that's not the reason. They feel their entire existence is threatened. That is why they do this.
Yeah.
And Ketu, what Ketu is? Ketu tells you that, look, you have everything now. But Ketu rules Scorpio. Scorpio is the original number 8 sign. So Scorpio is the sign of death, basically. Because 8th house is the house of death. So when Ketu gets activated, what happens? It's like a temporary feeling of death. Because what are dashas, basically? Dashas are like temporary time periods, right? Suppose 20 years Venus Mahadasha is active. So Venus is telling, now I am the king, you have to listen to me. You will invest in relationships and blah, 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 what will happen, and then I will tell you what to do. And then Ketu Dasha comes, Ketu is telling, now you have to listen to me. So Ketu is that, feel, that is why people feel headless during Ketu periods. Because what happens is, they feel that I have a territory. I have my job, I have my wife, my husband. My territory is there, I have won it. You see that flag? But when the Dasha gets active, they get a temporary feeling of death.
Yeah.
And death means everything is taken away from you. Your wife is sitting there next, but she can't do anything. Your husband can't do anything. So when Ketu Dasha gets activated, they feel as if they are staying with people who are what like death for them. So Ketu is giving you a trailer basically. Hey, look, because every Antar Dasha Ketu will come, Antar Dasha is a sub periods. Maybe your Ketu Mahadasha doesn't come, but Antar Dasha it will always come, right? And within that semi period also there is Pratyantar. So whenever Ketu period is activated, understand that it's like temporary death.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly that feeling you will feel at the peak when you are dying. Because Dasha is like a trailer, you see.
Mm-hmm.
For some time, the 8th house gets active. But when you are actually dying, 8th house is the only house which is active. When you are married, what happens? Which house is active? 7th house. When you have a child, which house is active? 5th house. And when you are dead, what happens? The 8th house is totally active in its peak. So then what happens is, we see that, okay, I had my empire, all these things, and now I have to leave. And then Rahu says, hey, there are some pages remaining in this book. Would you like to write some new lines here?
Yeah.
And then we again try to fulfill our desire. We again take birth. Again, Ketu will strip us. Again, this will happen.
Mm-hmm.
So this cycle keeps continuing. That is why people say that recently I had done a consultation for somebody. That person said that, I think, I went to Berlin. That's another story. But I recently went to Berlin. And there was one Indian lady. She came to Berlin in 1980. And she has her own restaurant and she's very prosperous. So she told me that the moment I went to Berlin Wall, which was, still there that time, I felt as if I've come home. Whenever I see the Russian, that Red Army, which penetrated through Berlin, whenever I see their photos, whenever I see Adolf Hitler, I feel that these people are like my family members.
Wow.
And the moment I go to India, in Delhi, I feel as if I've come to hell. I don't know these people. I had the most miserable relationship with my mother, with my father, my brother. Nobody likes me. I also hate them. Totally. But the moment I came here, I was like, man, I'm home. How in the universe? And this is how karma acts, you see. She was telling me how she came to Germany. And you will be astonished if you hear it. What happened? She, in 1980s, those days in India, ladies did not even used to work also. What to speak of somebody going abroad, and that to Germany was also not very famous. Unlike US and UK is one very famous location in India in those days. Even US was not very famous. So she said that what happened was, I was working like a waitress, waiter or waitress, whatever you call. And it was like just another day. And there was one newspaper, And my boss told me that, hey, my friend is going to come, give him this newspaper. And then she said, okay, I will give. And then she was just like, oh, wait a minute, what's there here? And then she saw that vacancies in Berlin, Germany. Yeah. Indian cooks need it. If interested, send a letter by post. Those days there was no email. Send a letter by post with your application. What you have cooked, when, for how many people. Maybe we consider it. And then she gave the application. And she said that they sent me a letter that, oh my God, you are so talented, you are so experienced, we want you so badly, please come. We will do all proceedings, visa and all the other nonsense we will handle. And she said, the moment I stepped inside Germany and when I went to Berlin Wall, I felt I have come home. That means she must have had some very strong karma related to, you know, that World War, that time. Maybe she was one of the soldiers. I don't know from which side, God knows. Or maybe anybody else. So that is what happens, you know, that we Ketu tells us, look, your kingdom is there, the flag is still there, but now you're gone basically. And then Rahu tells, hey, where are you going? Come here, I have a new list. You see, how can you miss the Bentley? You know, how can you miss this? How can you miss that? And then at the end, Saturn will come and Saturn is like, okay, you wanted a car, so you cheated on somebody. So now you have to pay this, you know. So that is repeating again and again. So Mars and Saturn is very important if you want to understand Rahu Ketu. So Mars shows hankering. Wherever Mars is placed in your chart, you will always find there is a hankering there. Hankering is, I want, I want, I want, I want, I want, I want. I want it at any cost. And wherever there is Saturn, you will see there is lamentation. Oh, I lost it. He's gone. She's gone. Whichever house Saturn is in. Saturn is in the seventh house. Your spouse can behave like that. Saturn is in the fourth house, then maybe the mother behaved like that. Anyways, so the point is, hankering and lamentation are like two sides of the same coin. It's like the mobile. It's the same mobile. That is why both are malefics, because this mobile itself is a malefic. And both are tormenting. And the solution to Mars and Saturn, because unless you treat Mars and Saturn, you cannot treat Rahu and Ketu. Because, see, when can you stop crying? When you realize that you don't have anything to lose.
That's very good.
Suppose you go outside and you see there's a big limousine standing, you know, $1 million limousine, which everybody may want. But suppose there's one person comes with a brick and he just hits the light. And he runs away. And then you will think, oh shit, that beautiful limousine is now broken. You see, very bad. I don't know how much it will cost to repair that light. But you won't sit and start crying. Oh my God, limousine is broken. Why you won't do that? Because you know that limousine is not yours. So when we know that everything is God's property, then we will not cry, because we know that it never belongs to us. For some temporary time, depending on our karma, we are allotted, okay, XYZ, this is your home, this is your wife, husband, take it. But that doesn't mean they belong to us. It's like a person who is staying in the White House, president of US. That is not his house. For some 4 years or 8 years, he's allowed to stay there because of his, you know, actions. But if tomorrow the president says, this is my house, I will stay here forever, then that can't happen, you see. And then what about Mars and Ketu? So regarding Saturn, when you know that nothing is yours, you will never cry, because you will only cry when you think this was mine and this is taken away. And then Mars and Ketu, the other extreme. There's no land to conquer. Because there is no use of conquering. It's like a headless battle, you see. Oh, today I have one car. Like recently I went to Berlin. I met one person. He has all the amenities in life. He's like the best life anybody can imagine. But he's still miserable. And he has 4 or 5 those big cars, you know. Maybe to get one of them, I have to walk for the rest of my life. But he said, you know, sir, I'm very unhappy actually. What to do? My life is like hell. Then I asked, why, sir? What's the problem? Actually, you know, I had a desire that the moment I open my eyes every morning, there will be 12 luxury cars in front of my home. And now I have only 4. I don't know that before I die, I will get 12 cars or not. And I was asking him, so by the way, what about your income monthly? And he said an amount, and then I was calculating my yearly. There's not much difference, you know. The moment he earns in maybe 15, 20 days is more than what I can earn in maybe 1.5 years. And he's so miserable, my God. You can't believe it. Totally unhappy. So then Mars is acting fully, you see. Because there is no lamentation now. Mars is telling, you need a car. You need, you need, you need, you need. So then Ketu is a malefic then. Because then what will happen? You will earn 12 luxury cars. Yes. And then at the time of death, you will feel so terrible. Oh my God, these cars are not mine. I am going. So then the pain is more, you see. So when we do spiritual practices, then we get rid of this idea of controllership and proprietorship. Because we find higher happiness when we chant mantras, when we talk about God, when we read the scriptures, when we spread the spiritual wisdom. Then the fulfillment is at the level of the soul.
Mm-hmm.
Then we realize that in the material world, either we have a Mercedes or a Rolls Royce. It's like a stone ultimately. Not that we don't have those. But we will not be obsessed and mad and attached with that. Oh my God, that's my car, you see. Because ultimately, the ethos will be active only. So that is how Mars and Saturn, they are related with Rahu and Ketu. And if I would go to Rahu Ketu specifically now, there is a concept of Dik Chakra, about which I will not explain now. It will become a long topic. But in the Dik Chakra, there is a concept of which planets actually can nullify the bad effects of another planet. Okay. So in that, if you see for Rahu, it is actually, as far as I remember, it is Mercury. Yes, it is Mercury. So Mercury is actually Lord Vishnu. He is the significator. So one mantra which we can always chant is Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. I will repeat, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. This mantra, if we chant 108 times every day morning, all the Rahu problems will vanish. We may have a big long list of the notebook and there may be 1,000 pages, but we will not pick up the pen again. We will not write new pages there. Because the more you write pages, the more you will cry later. So now this does not mean that you don't do your job or you divorce your wife and you go to the forest. It doesn't mean that. It means that whatever you are doing in your mundane materialistic life, we continue doing that as our responsibility. And we be like a normal human being. At the same time, we cultivate spiritual wisdom inside us by reading the scriptures, by chanting the mantras, by visiting holy places. If you can go to India, that's great. There are places like Haridwar. There are places like Mathura, Vrindavan. So many places are there where we can go and get a feeling of God and His presence. And whenever we meet somebody, instead of discussing on politics, on things like Game of Thrones, maybe we can discuss something. Hey, you know, today I read this shloka from the Srimad Bhagavatam. It says, Janmadhyasya yaton bhaya. That shloka is there, the first shloka. It's so beautiful. You can keep discussing on hours and hours from the first shloka itself. And Srimad Bhagavatam has 18,000 verses. And if you read one shloka every day, how many years you will need? 50 years. So you don't have to read 10 verses every day. Not even 5, not even 2. Just one verse every day. If you read that, then you will know. Because that book is paramount. Because Vyasdev, remember that story? Vyasdev wrote everything. And he was not happy. He said, because he had given all the materialistic stuff in it. But that scripture exclusively talks of God. Because there is a shloka in that which says, Dharma Projita Kaitavatro Paramo Nirmatsara Nam Satam. It means, in short, it means that Srimad Bhagavatam will kick out, that word is used, kick out. Any other varieties of religion. Any other varieties of religion doesn't mean Hindu or Muslim or Christian. And anything which gives you less of God. Less of God means when you like in India, there are many remedies, you know, like astrology. For Venus, there are remedies. For Saturn, for Mars. So when you are doing a remedy, is forgetting the higher purpose. What you are doing is you are saying that, God, I am not interested in you. I'm only interested in your resources. So if you can give me these, it's fine. Otherwise, bye-bye. So it is not giving you God. It is giving you his resources. So then you lose out, actually. And that's the crux of Srimad Bhagavatam. It says, nothing else is allowed here. Only that which will, only those words are allowed, which will take you ultimately to God, not to his petty resources. Like in Hindi, they say, na, roti kapra makan. It's like food, clothing, shelter. That's what everybody is running behind. That Srimad Bhagavatam does not allow. It says, none of those texts are here. So that is what is there about Rahu and Ketu. And what else? I mean, I can go on speaking for hours.
I guess the last question I have before, because I know it's pretty late there, it's just like